Episodes, right? These are my episodes.
My head's gonna get too big.
Okay, so we have to talk about inorganic versus organic. So all compounds in our body can be classified as either an organic compound or an inorganic compound. Something that is inorganic does not have both carbon and hydrogen. Okay, if it's an organic compound, it has to have both carbon and hydrogen. So inorganic compounds don't have both carbon and hydrogen. We've got lots of different inorganic things in our body. So carbon dioxide, for example, and oxygen, the two respiratory gases. Carbon dioxide is CO2. It's got carbon, but it does not have a hydrogen. So it's inorganic. Oxygen doesn't have either. Water has hydrogen, but no carbon. Inorganic. There are some acids and bases that are inorganic. We have some acids that are organic, so you can't just say all acids are inorganic because there's some in each category. Again, the key is just that it has to have carbon and hydrogen in order to be organic. So for example, like we just talked about hydrochloric acid. That has hydrogen, but no carbon. So that would be inorganic. And then salts. So like the sodium chloride, calcium chloride, potassium chloride, any of these salts, all these ionic things are inorganic. So organic compounds then are molecules or compounds that do have both carbon and hydrogen. They usually have oxygen too, but that is not a requirement. Most of them do. But they have to have carbon and hydrogen. And these are covalently bonded together. Okay, these are bonds where they're sharing electrons with each other. Nice, strong covalent bonds. Organic compounds include things like carbohydrates, so sugars and starches, proteins, lipids like phospholipids and steroids and cholesterol, and then nucleic acids. Nucleic acids are in the high energy compound, that ATP that we've brought up a few times. They're also in DNA, they're in RNA. So we see nucleic acids in a few different places. So we're going to spend the whole rest of this chapter, so the rest of today's lecture and all of Monday's lecture, talking through organic compounds. Okay, when we talk about the organic compounds, we'll go through each of the different categories, and we'll talk about their structure, we'll talk about the way we make them, the way we break them down, and we'll talk about their function. So a big part of the chemistry is just these organic compounds. And it's important. A lot of this will come back when we talk about digestion, we'll talk about it. When we talk about absorption, we'll talk about it. When we talk about kidneys, we'll talk about it. So a lot of this will come back to us over the next year. Again, we mentioned that if something is organic, it has to have carbon and hydrogen. Usually has some oxygen, but that's not a rule. Okay, it has to have carbon and hydrogen. And I mentioned that they are covalently bonded. What does that mean again?
Sharing
pairs of electrons. Good. When we look at these organic compounds, they have what we call a carbon backbone or a hydrocarbon backbone. What that means is there's some section of the compound that's based off of a bunch of carbon and hydrogen. Sometimes it's all stretched out in a line. So you'll have like carbon, 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 and there's a bunch of hydrogens attached to these. Okay, like this. So a ton of carbon and hydrogen. Sometimes they'll be in a ring shape. So you can have like carbon, 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 like this. And you can have different numbers of molecules and different size rings, and they'll have hydrogens all attached to them. Okay, so the point is that you have this general structure that's got a ton of carbon and hydrogen. And then we have what we call functional groups attached to that. So you'll have this big long chain of carbon and hydrogen, and then you'll have, that's an O, something like this. That's a functional group that we call a carboxyl group or carboxylic acid. This is just kind of meh, general, whatever. This functional group is what determines how it behaves and what it is. Okay, so as we look at all these different things, if we look at carbohydrates or proteins or lipids, we'll see the certain kind of key groups that make them stand out or that make them different from everything else. And that determines, again, its behavior and what it is that molecule or that compound is actually going to do. Again, we'll talk about carbohydrates like sugars and starches. We'll talk about lipids like fatty acids, cholesterol, steroids, phospholipids. We'll talk about proteins, which are made up of chains of smaller molecules called amino acids. And then we'll also talk about nucleic acids like in DNA and RNA. Here we see some typical functional groups. This is organic chemistry at its finest. I'm not gonna ask you to memorize or reproduce this at all. I just wanna kind of point out a couple things because as we go forward, I'll say, oh, the amino acid has an amino group. And you'll be like, what the heck is an amino group? You can look back at your chart, okay? Or we call it an amino acid because of the carboxyl group or the carboxylic acid. And you can look back and see what the carboxylic acid is. So again, these are these functional groups. What this R is it's kind of like a variable. That's that long hydrocarbon chain. So this R could be, you know, 10 carbons long. It could be 5 carbons long. It could be 20 carbons long. It could be 6 carbons in a ring. It could be anything. The point is that that's a bunch of carbon and hydrogen. Okay? That's what makes it an organic compound. So here we see a carboxyl group. This is also called, or classically it was called, carboxylic acid. So when we see things like nucleic acid or amino acid, that's where that word acid is coming from, because it has a carboxylic acid group. This is what it looks like. Okay, a carbon double bonded to oxygen, and then a OH. Okay, again, so we see them in things like fatty acids, bless you, and amino acids. An amino group, okay, is an NH2. So again, this R could be any number of carbons and hydrogens or rings or whatever, and then it's got nitrogen and 2 hydrogen. Okay, amino, hence being in amino acids. And that's why we call these big structures that we make amino acids, because they have an amino group. Hydroxyls and OH, we don't worry about it too much, but you see them in a lot of different molecules. You see them in like alcohols and stuff too. And then a phosphate group as well. Here we see phospholipids is where we'll really see that phosphate group for our purposes. Again, I won't ask you to reproduce anything from there. It's just kind of a little background knowledge. All right, so we're gonna launch right into carbohydrates. Again, I'm sure everyone's heard the term carbohydrate, right? Anybody who's dieting says they're gonna cut out carbohydrates. We actually need carbohydrates. your brain runs off of them. But carbohydrates are organic compounds. So what does that mean they have to have? Carbon and hydrogen. Are they bonded together ionically or covalently? Covalently, good. Carbohydrates happen to have carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen in a 1:2:1 ratio. Okay, so 1:2:1. What that means is that for every 1 carbon, there's 2 hydrogen and 1 oxygen. So the classic carbohydrate that we always talk about is glucose. The formula is C6H12O6. So look at this. There should be 2 times as many hydrogens as there are carbons, right?
Yep.
2 for every 1. So look, 6 times 2 is 12, right? And there should be the same number of carbon and oxygen. Look, most carbohydrates will have that ratio, or really close to it, okay? When we look at carbohydrates include sugars and starches that we use as an energy source. So glucose, for example, is very easy for our cells to break down and produce ATP. That's how we produce that cellular fuel that we use. We use carbohydrates mainly for energy. We classify carbohydrates based on their size, essentially. So based on the number of little sugar rings that they have present. We can say that carbohydrates are monosaccharides, disaccharides, or polysaccharides. Monosaccharide is a simple sugar, so it's like one ring. Hey, okay, remember there's carbons, and there's actually an oxygen in there as well. But it's one ring, just one. Mono means one, right? So one sugar is a monosaccharide. If we link two of those sugar rings together, then we get a disaccharide, right? Di means two. If we link many of them together, then we get a much larger molecule that's called a polysaccharide. So we'll look at those in more detail right here. So a monosaccharide, again, is a simple sugar. It typically has one ring. Okay, so one little circle, it's not really a circle, one ring with six carbons is the most common for monosaccharides. The one that I want you to memorize is glucose. That glucose is a monosaccharide. Fructose and galactose are also monosaccharides. Interestingly enough, glucose and fructose are both C6H12O6. It's just that the molecules are arranged in different places. They're isomers, so they have the same chemical formula, but they're in different spots. Okay. So disaccharides. Di, remember again, means two. So that's two simple sugars linked together. And look, how do we hook them together? With dehydration synthesis. So we have two separate sugars. We link them together by performing a dehydration synthesis reaction. Okay, we'll have like an OH group and an OH. We pull H2O out and form a bond. Okay, we'll look at it on the next slide. So every time we try and link sugars together to hook them all together and make a bigger molecule, we do a dehydration synthesis reaction. Polysaccharides are bigger molecules that have many monosaccharides or many sugars all linked together. Again, every time you link another sugar on there, you do another dehydration synthesis reaction. So you pull out of water, make a bond to link another sugar. Pull out of water, make a bond to hook another one on. And you can get really, really big molecules. Polysaccharides include things like starch. Starch is the polysaccharide, the carbohydrate that we eat, like potatoes and grains. Cellulose is a big polysaccharide that's in plants. We don't actually break that down, but that's in plant cell walls. And glycogen is very, very important. Glycogen is how we store glucose in muscles and the liver. We'll look at what glycogen looks like in like, I think, a couple slides. But essentially what happens is when we eat a meal and we have a ton of sugar in our blood, we put it away until we need it later. Okay, just like money, right? If you get paid and you've got a ton of cash, you don't walk around carrying a few grand in your pocket, right? You put that money into your bank account. And then later when you don't have any money on you, you take a little bit of money out of the bank. Okay, so we do this with sugar. You eat a meal, you have a ton of sugar in your blood. You don't need it all right then. So you pack it away in the bank. You pack that sugar away for later until you haven't eaten in 3 hours and all of a sudden you need some sugar. And then you start to take it out of the bank. Glycogen is the bank. Glycogen is how we store that sugar until we need it for later. Again, we'll look at the structure in a second and how it is that we actually do that. All right. So on the left here, we see glucose and we see fructose. What would you classify these as? So this is glucose, this is fructose. What are those? Monosaccharides, disaccharides? Monosaccharides, right? It's one ring, okay? At each of these corners, there's a carbon. We just don't write them. It's implied. It just takes up too much space and time to write them. Okay, so yes, those are monosaccharides. It's one ring. Now we're gonna link them together. We do that via dehydration synthesis. So dehydrate, we pull out a water and we form a bond right here at this oxygen. So you see if we progress forward, now we have one disaccharide. Good, I was gonna say one molecule.
What is it?
Disaccharide, right? So there's two sugars linked together. That's a disaccharide. And here's the water that we pulled out. Now, what's the opposite of dehydration synthesis?
Hydrolysis.
So, when we use sugars for fuel, we break down monosaccharides. Our cells use monosaccharides for fuel. So if I had this floating around and I needed to use it for fuel, I would have to break that
into monosaccharides before I could convert it into ATP and use it for fuel. So the way I would break that is via hydrolysis, right? This water would come in and break that bond. It's just the opposite of what we did to form the bond. Hydrolysis would break the bond and separate them so that we had two separate sugars and we could then burn them, right? We could use them for fuel. Showing you the hydrolysis reaction, right? So the water separates hydrogen and OH, it comes in, it breaks the bond, and now we're back to our two different monosaccharides.
What's the value of sucrose versus fructose? I've seen that in like juice drinks.
So the sucrose you just end up having to break down. The sucrose you have to break down in your GI tract before you can absorb it and utilize it. So, but we do, I mean, we have the enzymes to break it down. But it just requires an extra step to break down before we can absorb it and use it as fuel.
So the fructose makes it easier
to absorb and digest. What's up?
So would polysaccharides also be broken down the same way as the...
Yes.
Yeah.
Yep, we're going to look at it right now. They're formed the same way and broken down the same way. Okay, hey, good question. So this is glycogen. Okay. Our kind of super important polysaccharide. Glycogen, remember, is how we store
glucose.
Okay? So if you look at this is a huge molecule. Each of these circles is actually a glucose molecule. So if we were to like just blow up this one little section of it right here, this is what it looks like. This is a big complex molecule. Mm-hmm. Okay, multiply that by 15. So there's lots and lots of sugar molecules all linked together to make this glycogen. So again, what happens is you'll eat a meal, you've got a ton of sugar in your blood and you don't need it. You're not going to use it then. So in your liver and in your muscles, you store that glucose. You store it as glycogen. So in order to link all of these glucose molecules together, you do dehydration synthesis reactions every single time. So right here, that was a dehydration synthesis reaction. To link these, that was a dehydration synthesis. Here, 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 everywhere you link them together, it was a dehydration synthesis reaction that occurred. Now, then we get this big, huge glycogen, and that's in our muscle, it's in our livers, we're fine. A couple hours goes by, we've used that free glucose that we had, and we don't have it anymore, and now our cells are hungry for it. Right? Our cells need glucose to make energy. Then we start to break this glycogen down. Right? That's when you go make a withdrawal from the bank. And how do we do that? What kind of reactions do we use to break it?
Hydrolysis.
Good, hydrolysis. So then water just comes in and breaks that bond. Now, what kind of glucose I can use? Water comes in, breaks the bond, you've got a glucose. Water comes in and breaks the bond, you've got a glucose. Okay, so we store it when we've got a lot with dehydration synthesis. Then we break it down when we don't have enough with hydrolysis. This again is just kind of a little chart to show you the different carbohydrates, right? The monosaccharides, disaccharides, and polysaccharides. And these terms will come back. Like the glycogen conversation comes back when we do endocrine and we talk about stuff like insulin and glucagon. We'll talk about glycogen a lot.
I mean, hyperglycemic is too much
sugar. Yep, because hyper is above normal. So hyperglycemia is when your blood sugar is too high. Hypoglycemia is when your blood sugar is too low. Yep. All right, so next we'll get to lipids. And we definitely won't get through all of these, but we'll get through a little bit of it today. So lipids are organic compounds because they have carbon and hydrogen. When we talk about lipids, lipids are mainly hydrophobic. What did that mean again?
I'm scared of water,
right? Water fury. They don't like water. So lipids don't mix with water very well. They include things like fats and oils and waxes. When we look at lipids, they have carbon and hydrogen in a 1-to-2 ratio. They have much fewer oxygen atoms. That's why they're hydrophobic.
It's that oxygen that's present in glucose that gives it its polarity. Without the oxygen, if we just have hydrocarbon chains, that's really balanced. That is nonpolar. Nonpolar things are hydrophobic. They don't interact with water because water is polar. When we look at lipids, they're really versatile. There's a lot of different functions for lipids. They make up the structural components of cells. So when we look at the plasma membrane, the outer barrier that goes all around the outside of our cell, we'll see that it's made up of a lot of lipids. We call them phospholipids. We use them as energy reserves. So we like to burn glucose for fuel. That's our kind of primary go-to for fuel. But if we don't have enough glucose, you better believe we will break down fats. Okay, we'll break down fatty acids, and we can do that for energy as well. We also utilize lipids as hormones. You've, I'm sure, all heard of steroid hormones. So stuff like estrogen and testosterone and progesterone, those are lipids, okay? So the lipids that we'll talk about today include fatty acids. Those are the ones that we use for fuel or energy. Glycerides, which is how we store fatty acids. Steroids, which are our hormones. And then phospholipids, those are the ones that make up our cell membrane. All right, so we'll start by talking about fatty acids. Fatty acids are long chains of carbon and hydrogen. Okay, so again, you'll have this like carbon, 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 and they've got all these hydrogens, right? So all of these are hydrogens attached. And then at one end, you'll have a carboxyl group. Hey, remember carboxyl? We said it's called carboxylic acid. So that's this fatty acid. You have this big fatty part, right? Lipids with hydrogens and carbons. And then you have this acid on one end. When we look at fatty acids, they're relatively nonpolar, right? Wherever we have these hydrogens and carbons, they're nonpolar. They're nice, they're balanced. The only part of it that's got a polar aspect is the very end. But for the most part, this whole long chain that we'll have is nonpolar. So that means that they have very limited solubility in water. They don't interact or dissolve in water very well because they have these long fatty chains. That's why we say that they are hydrophobic. When we look at fatty acids, the primary function of a fatty acid is that we use it as an energy source. Fatty acids actually provide more energy than glucose does. It's just that they're hard to break down. Glucose is really easy for our cells to go and break down, so they prefer to break down glucose. Again, if there's not glucose around, your cells will just break down the fatty acids for energy. When we talk about fatty acids, we can describe them as being saturated or unsaturated. And I'm sure you've heard this before, right? You look at the nutrition label, like, oh, how much saturated fat does it have? This is what you're talking about. If something is saturated, we're saying that it's saturated with hydrogen. So there's hydrogen everywhere that there could possibly be hydrogen, and there are no double bonds here between the carbons. So something that's saturated means that there are no double bonds. These are the animal fats. Okay, they are bad fats. Saturated fats are bad for you. They're worse for you than unsaturated fats. Unsaturated fats have one or more double bonds. So somewhere in here, you'll have a double bond between the carbons. Okay, that's an unsaturated. Those are plant fats. Those aren't typically good fats. Those are better fats for you because that double bond we'll see creates a bend or a kink in that long tail. So this is a typical fatty acid. Again, guys, I'll never give you a structure like this and say, tell me what this is. That's just not the point of this class. But I expect you to know, that a fatty acid is used for energy. I expect you to know that a saturated fatty acid means no double bonds. And like verbally, I expect you to be able to kind of, feed me back the same stuff that we're talking through. But I won't ever give you a structure and make you recognize that. Okay, like you would have to in chemistry. There's all different fatty acids. There's lots of different fatty acids. But this is kind of a classic fatty acid. Again, there's this long chain of hydrogen and carbons. It's really balanced, it's nonpolar, it is hydrophobic, it doesn't like water. This is just the carboxylic acid part on the end. That's the only part that might interact with water a little bit, but for the most part, this thing does not like water. This shows us the difference between a saturated fatty acid and an unsaturated fatty acid. So notice when it's saturated, there are no double bonds, right? And it's a nice straight tail, or bad actually, but it's a straight tail. This is unsaturated. So there's a double bond here. And the result is that when you actually look at the molecule, it creates a kink in it. The importance there is that they can't pack as tightly. So you can't pack the fats in super, super densely when you have this kink. All right, so let's see if we can do two more slides. So remember sugars, right? We have these glucose molecules, and the way that we store them is by linking them all together, right? We just link them straight to each other to make this big glycogen to store it. Fatty acids cannot be linked directly to each other. So we have a problem when we want to store them. We need some way to create a bigger molecule and kind of link them together, but we can't link them directly to each other. So what we do is we add them to a glycerol molecule. It's kind of like this head molecule that we can attach a bunch of stuff to, like a charm bracelet, right? You wouldn't link 10 charms just all to each other and have this clump of charms, but you can link the charms to the bracelet, right? They need something to attach them to. So that's what we do with fatty acids. And we create these molecules called glycerides. Okay, so a glyceride is a glycerol head, and then we can attach fatty acids to it. Okay, that's how we link fatty acids together to make bigger molecules. We attach them to a head molecule, and we create this glyceride. Now, if we have a glycerol plus one fatty acid, that's something called a monoglyceride. If we have glycerol plus two fatty acids, that's a diglyceride. Okay, mono means one, di means two. If I have glycerol plus three fatty acids, it is a triglyceride. A tri means three, right? Like a tricycle has three wheels. You've all heard of triglycerides, right? You go to the doctor, you get your cholesterol checked, they check your triglyceride level. This is what they're checking. Okay, a glycerol with three, so a glycerol head with three fatty acids attached to it. Triglycerides have a few important functions. Change this word source to energy storage. This is how we store fatty acids. We said we can use these fatty acids for energy. If we have a ton of them floating around and we're not burning them, we're not using them, we convert them to triglycerides and we store them. That's this nice fat layer that's under our skin. That's us storing a bunch of fatty acids for later in case we need them. They also act as insulators and provide protection. So that's why animals who live in the Arctic have this nice thick layer of blubber to protect them from the cold. It insulates, it helps kind of keep the warmth in, protects us from fluctuations in temperature. And then also protection. We have, in a lot of different areas or a lot of different organs, we'll have little areas where we have little layers of fat, little layers of, or areas of triglycerides, and we're just kind of cushioning blood vessels, or we might be cushioning a delicate part of an organ to provide a little bit of protection there. And we'll do this slide and stop. So this is just showing us the way that we link fatty acids together to make triglycerides, and then how we break them down. And what do you know? We're looking at dehydration synthesis and hydrolysis again. And I told you these reactions happen a lot. So here everything is separate, right? Glycerol, and then there's one, two, three fatty acids. We do a dehydration synthesis right here, right? We pull the water out and form a bond. Here, pull the water out, form a bond. Here, pull the water out, form a bond. And now look, bond, 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 they're all linked. That's our triglyceride.
You eat a bunch of fat, you're not using it, you create these, you store them under your skin. If you don't have enough fuel and you need to use this fuel, you'll take these and you'll do hydrolysis. Right, the water will come in and break that bond. Now you've got a fatty acid that you can use. Water comes in, breaks the bond, now you got a fatty acid you can use. Okay? All right, any questions?
Kind of a lot, sorry. All right, I'll see y'all in the lab.